A very good afternoon to all of you. You're watching Midday News. My name is Aditi Nagpal Kirotra. Let's get the bulletin rolling with the headlines first. Political drama continues in Maharashtra. Shiv Sena indicates breaking ties with BJP. NCP says final call over government formation to be taken by Congress Working Committee. Shiv Sena to meet Governor at 2:30 p.m. Notification for second phase of Jharkhand elections issued. BJP announces first list of 52 candidates. CM Raghubar Das to contest from Jamshedpur East. Congress names 5 JMM 3 candidates. Time for India to once again emerge as a global hub of learning, says Vice President M. Venkaiya Naidu in his address at JNU convocation. Calls on universities to focus on research, holistic vision for education. In a major breakthrough, two terrorists killed in encounter in Bandipura. Arms and ammunition recovered. Railway authorities conduct track inspection and trial run in Kashmir ahead of resumption of services tomorrow. Deepak Chahar becomes first Indian to take hat-trick in 2020 cricket, helps India beat Bangladesh by 30 runs and win series 2-1. Suspense over government formation in Maharashtra continues as Governor Bhagat Singh Koshyari invited Shiv Sena to form government on Sunday, hours after the BJP declined to form government, citing lack of numbers. Shiv Sena leader Sanjay Raut has indicated breaking its alliance with the BJP, saying there was no point in continuing the alliance if the BJP was not willing to share the chief minister's post. Earlier today, party's Arvind Sawant resigned from Prime Minister Narendra Modi's cabinet. Shiv Sena chief and party leaders will meet the governor at 2:30 p.m. today. With 56 MLAs, Shiv Sena is the second largest party and has time till 7:30 today to stake claim to power.
देखिए भारतीय जनता पार्टी ने कल राज्यपाल से जाकर कहा है, राज्यपाल महोदय से, कि हम सरकार नहीं बना सकते, हमें मैंडेट नहीं है और शिवसेना हमारे साथ आने को तैयार नहीं, इसलिए हम बहुमत नहीं जुटा पा रहे, इसलिए हम अपोजिशन में बैठेंगे। ये उनका अहंकार है महाराष्ट्र की जनता के प्रति, उनका एक तरह से अपमान है। अपोजिशन में बैठने को तैयार है लेकिन जो बात तय हुई थी, जो एग्रीमेंट हुआ था 50-50 फॉर्मूला वाला, अढ़ाई अढ़ाई साल के मुख्यमंत्री पद बांटने के लिए, वो देने को तैयार नहीं। आप उससे समझ सकते हैं किसके दिमाग में क्या था पहले भी और आज भी। अगर दोनों ने जो एग्रीमेंट किया था, जो बात तय हुई थी, उसके ऊपर अमल करता तो महाराष्ट्र में आज की जो स्थिति है वो निर्माण नहीं होती। लेकिन किसी भी हालत शिवसेना को मुख्यमंत्री पद नहीं देंगे, 50-50 वाला फॉर्मूला के ऊपर काम नहीं करेंगे, चाहे हमको विपक्ष में बैठना पड़े। इस अहंकार को महाराष्ट्र की जनता का मैं अपमान मानता।
Meanwhile, opposition Congress and NCP, who have 44 and 54 MLAs respectively in the assembly, is keeping a close watch on the developments. NCP leaders too held meeting with its top leaders and said that while Congress MLAs are in favour of supporting Shiv Sena-led government, the final decision will be taken by the Congress Working Committee. Senior Congress leaders Ahmed Patel, K.C. Venugopal and Mallikarjun Kharge met with party interim president Sonia Gandhi over the political situation. Congress leaders will now meet its Maharashtra leaders for further discussions in the evening today.
People are given a mandate to sit in opposition. So at present, the same position status is there. I don't want to tell beyond that. Today there is a meeting at 10 o'clock. Then what instruction high commands give, that according to that we will go. But our original decision and decision of the people that we should sit in opposition, that is the position.
The BJP leaders, after declining the governor's invitation, will meet today to discuss a future course of action. The BJP and the Shiv Sena contested the Maharashtra Assembly election as an alliance and were given a clear majority, 161 seats in the 288-member house. The BJP had won 105 out of 161 seats. As political deadlock continues in the state, of a quick recap of all the developments in the state since the announcement of results last month. The BJP and the Shiv Sena contested as an alliance and were given a clear majority, 161 seats, in the 288-member house. The other alliance of the NCP Congress got 98 seats. However, the BJP and Shiv Sena failed to arrive at a consensus over government formation after both parties accused each other of failing to honour terms of the pre-poll alliance. CM and BJP leader Devendra Fadnavis resigned on Friday, a day before the term of the 13th State Assembly ended. On Saturday, the BJP turned down governor's invitation to form the government, citing lack of numbers, following which the government has now invited the second largest party, Shiv Sena, to form government. With 56 MLAs in the state, Shiv Sena is 89 MLAs short of the halfway mark in the assembly. If no alliance or party expresses confidence of forming the government, the governor will have to send a report to the centre recommending president's rule in Maharashtra. Notification for the second phase of Jharkhand Assembly polls will be issued today. Second phase polling in Jharkhand will be held on 7th of December. Jharkhand will vote in five phases, with the first one on 30th November and the last one on 20th December. The results will be declared on 23rd of December. BJP has announced names of candidates for 52 seats out of 81 seats for the upcoming Jharkhand Assembly polls. Chief Minister Raghubar Das will contest from Jamshedpur East and BJP's Jharkhand Party President Lakshman Gilwa will contest from Chakradharpur.
अभी 52 सीटों की अभी जो चुनाव समिति में उनके नाम अप्रूव किए हैं उनकी मैं यहां से घोषणा करता हूं और 81 टोटल सीटें हैं प्रदेश के एसएसवी मुख्यमंत्री जिनके नेतृत्व में लगातार प्रदेश आगे बढ़ रहा है ऐसे श्री रघुवर दास जी जमशेदपुर ईस्ट से चुनाव लड़ेंगे प्रदेश के अध्यक्ष भारतीय जनता पार्टी के श्री लक्ष्मण गिलुआ वह चक्रधरपुर से चुनाव लड़ेंगे एसटी को अभी तक जितनी घोषणा हुई है 17 सीटें अभी पार्टी ने दिया है जो 52 सीटों की घोषणा हुई है ओबीसी अभी तक 21 आउट ऑफ 52 महिलाएं 5 आउट ऑफ 52 वर्तमान विधायक जो हैं उनमें जो अभी इस लिस्ट में 30 सिटिंग एमएलए हैं 30 सिटिंग एमएलए और केवल इसमें से 10 का टिकट कटा है
Congress has released first list of 5 candidates. JMM has announced first list of 3 candidates for Jharkhand polls now. On a trip to West Bengal, President Ram Nath Kovind attended the convocation ceremony of the Vishwa Bharati University. Addressing the ceremony, President Kovind said that his visit to the university was like a pilgrimage, as Mahatma Gandhi and Tagore used to frequently meet there. He said that the Vishwa Bharati University that was established by Rabindranath Tagore was a place that reimagined the values that define India.
When the two titans met later, Gurudev addressed Gandhiji as Mahatma. The epithet was not new, but it gained currency after it received the mark of Tagore's approval. The two great minds united by their deep concern for the nation, its rich heritage, and its contemporary poverty struck instant rapport. Being original thinkers, they disagreed on countless issues the ideas of India, the varieties of nationalisms, the method of politics, and so on. In their frequent debates, however, they were not only civil to each other, but full of heartfelt admiration for each other. That is why these debates generated not heat, but light.
Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu has said that the time has come for India to once again emerge as a global hub of learning. Addressing the convocation ceremony at the Jawaharlal Nehru University, Vice President called upon all universities and institutions of higher learning to reorient their methods of teaching and focus more on research. He stressed on the need for bringing back the holistic vision for education and multidisciplinary approach of learning.
Convocation is always an important event for any academic institution and a significant milestone in your academic growth. I am now recollecting my days when I first received my degree. It is a moment of pride and joy for the degree holders and winners of medals and prizes. The degrees, medals, prizes earned by you are the recognition for your hard work and immense dedication. It is surely a moment of great pride for our teachers and parents as well. Learning is a never-ending process, and the firm foundation provided to you by your alma mater will empower you to explore new horizons in your life. Because learning is a lifelong experience. Because new opportunities are coming, new challenges are coming, new situations are emerging, so one must continue to learn. As Swami Vivekananda has said almost 100 years ago, I quote, "Intelligence must not remain the monopoly of the cultured few. The immense power of a people for work must be utilized. India's potential are great," unquote. Leaving no one behind is the overreaching goal of our government and the sustainable development goals. Equity and quality must be the watchwords of all our educational institutions. As you all are aware, India was once known as Vishwaguru. My dear students and the teachers, the time has come for India to once again emerge as a global hub of learning. For this to happen, our universities and institutions of higher learning have to reorient their methods of teaching and focus more sharply on research.
He expressed his happiness over the fact that women constitute 51% of the students in JNU because of special admission policy. He stressed on the need for political empowerment of women by providing adequate reservation for them in parliament and state legislatures. He said that JNU has become synonymous with academic excellence in the country. He lauded JNU for receiving the highest ranking, grade A++, from NAAC recently. Union HRD Minister Ramesh Pokhriyal Nishank was present at the occasion.
Sri Jawaharlal Nehru University, which was established as a central university by an Act of Parliament in 1966, is celebrating its golden jubilee this year. It's a matter of pride that JNU had become synonymous with academic excellence in the country. It is synonymous with academic excellence in the country. I'm happy to note that JNU had recently received the highest ranking, grade A++, from NAAC, National Assessment and Accreditation Council. And also JNU was ranked number 2 among all the universities in India by the National Institutional Ranking Framework, Government of India, 2017 and 18. Second rank. And I hope that you people will take a decision, including the management, that to gain the first rank in the near future. Besides this, JNU was also a recipient of the Best University Award from the President of India. My congratulations to all the concerned.
Atal ji ne kaha tha nahi jai jawan jai kisan के बाद अब जय विज्ञान होना चाहिए, और विज्ञान में हमने पराकाष्ठा को चूमा था और दुनिया में महाशक्ति के रूप में भारत को स्थापित किया था अटल जी ने। और अब हमारे प्रधानमंत्री जी ने कहा कि विज्ञान के बाद अनुसंधान की जरूरत है। अब पूरी दुनिया हमको देख रही है इस समय, हमको पूरी निगाह टिकाए हुए हैं हिंदुस्तान पर, क्योंकि पूरी जिस तरीके से परिस्थितियां बदल रही हैं उन परिस्थितियों में भारत सबकी आशाओं का केंद्र है। और इसलिए हमारे प्रधानमंत्री जी ने, नरेंद्र मोदी जी ने जय जवान जय किसान और जय विज्ञान के बाद जय अनुसंधान की बात की है।
With this, we'll halt in for a quick break, but we'll be back soon. Stay tuned with us.
Delhi, for centuries, has nurtured many kingdoms and rulers. These kingdoms have left us several significant monuments with an incredible history to tell. Among these monuments is one which is in the midst of posh bungalows in horse cars area, the Chor Minar. Built under the rule of Alauddin Khilji, telling a statement of his rule, is believed to have stood out as a deterrent for thieves and thugs who attempted to venture in his kingdom. Built in 13th century, the pillar is made of rubble masonry and stands at the center of a platform. Each of the four sides of the platform has three arched recesses with a doorway on one side leading to a spiral staircase. The pillar, also believed to be known as the Tower of Thieves, was used to display the severed heads of the thieves and thugs through its 225 holes.
Indian people have now given the thumbs up to Rajya Sabha television. RSTV's growth has been phenomenal, with the journey from 2 million to 3 million being completed in less than 6 months. That's over 6,200 new subscribers every day. Our online viewers are engaging with us more actively. Every day, thousands like, share and comment on our videos. So come and join this growing tribe of RSTV viewers and get ready for an exciting journey.
Welcome back. You're still with us on Midday News. In a breakthrough for the security forces in Jammu and Kashmir, two terrorists have been killed in Bandipura in an encounter with security forces. Arms and ammunition have been recovered from the encounter site. Meanwhile, railway services are set to resume in the valley over 3 months after they were suspended on the day centre announced scrapping of Article 370 provisions. Railway officials carried out track inspection and trial runs today to ensure smooth functioning. Justice Sanjay Karol took oath as the 43rd Chief Justice of Patna High Court. He was administered oath of office and secrecy by Bihar Governor Phagu Chauhan. Justice Karol was earlier posted as Chief Justice of Tripura High Court. Cyclone Bulbul has claimed 10 lives in West Bengal and 2 lives in Odisha. Over 2.7 lakh families have been affected by the cyclone across West Bengal as a severe cyclonic storm unleashed heavy rains and gale winds in the state on Sunday. 1.78 lakh people were moved to relief camps. State Disaster Management Minister Javed Khan said that at least 2,473 houses were destroyed and another 26,000 were partially damaged in the coastal districts along the Bay of Bengal. Prime Minister Narendra Modi spoke to Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee and assured of all help from the centre. Cyclone Bulbul claimed 2 lives as it wreaked havoc in most parts of coastal Odisha. Even though it didn't make landfall in Odisha, the cyclone caused extensive damage to crops in the coastal districts. Odisha Chief Minister Naveen Patnaik will make an aerial survey of the affected districts today to review damage caused by the calamity. Making landfall in Bangladesh on Sunday, Cyclone Bulbul ravaged its coastal areas as well, killing at least 8 people. over 21 lakh people were evacuated. And now let's talk about environment and climate change. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change's report release says that anthropogenic climate change has observed increased precipitation, winds, and extreme sea level events associated with some tropical cyclones. The unusual increase in number of severe cyclones this year is attributed to uncontrolled human activities in the coastal regions. Normally, there are 3 to 4 cyclones annually, but this year, 7 cyclones have already occurred so far. 4 cyclones were formed in the Arabian Sea, namely Vayu, Hika, Kyar and Maha, while 3 cyclones were formed in the Bay of Bengal, Babuk, Fani and Bulbul. The main reason for this is due to increase in sea temperatures, which has caused changes in the weather conditions. Former Chief Election Commissioner T.N. Sishan passed away in Chennai on Sunday night. 86-year-old Sishan died of cardiac arrest. He was not keeping well for the past couple of years. A 1955 batch IAS officer of the Tamil Nadu cadre, Sishan had led the Election Commission from 1990 to 1996. He has been credited with game-changing electoral reforms in the 1990s and enforcing the Model Code of Conduct. He held various key posts in the government, including that of Defence Secretary and Cabinet Secretary. Paying tribute to T.N. Sishan, President Ramnath Kovind said that Sishan's stint as Chief Election Commissioner marked an epical phase of electoral reforms. Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu, in his condolence message, credited Sishan for a number of reforms that gave the Election Commission the stature it enjoys today. PM Narendra Modi called T.N. Sishan an outstanding civil servant who served the country with utmost diligence and integrity. He added that Sishan's efforts towards electoral reforms made our democracy stronger and more participative. Parliament paid tribute to the first education minister of the country and eminent freedom fighter Maulana Abul Kalam Azad on his birth anniversary today. A function to pay tribute to him was organised in Centre Hall of Parliament, where MPs offered flowers at his portrait. His birth anniversary is being observed as National Education Day. India beat Bangladesh by 30 runs in 2020 International Series in Nagpur on Sunday. India scored 174 runs with a loss of 5 wickets in 20 overs. S.S. Iyer scored 62 while K.L. Rahul made 52 runs. In their reply, Bangladesh managed to score just 144 in 19.2 overs. Deepak Chahar created history as he returned with the best ever bowling figures in 2020 internationals, beating the previous record held by Sri Lanka's Ajanta Mendis. While doing so, Chahar also picked up a hat-trick, the first by an Indian in 2020s. Earlier, Bangladesh won the toss and elected to field. And with this, it's a wrap on this edition of Midday News. Thank you so much for your time.